Christ, I welcome you to this time of celebration, time of giving thanks, time of remembering. As we come together this afternoon, I know that you have had a great time this morning celebrating the anniversary year with Reverend Small and others who have joined you for this time of fellowship, of praise, and of worship. And I trust that it was a good time. I've heard that it was. As we come here this afternoon, we come to remember what has been important to us in the life of this church over the years, and to celebrate that. And we pray that it will be a time of remembering, that we may go forth from here with the sense that God is leading us to new and greater things as we join together in the inauguration next week. So I welcome you, I welcome those who may be visiting, who have returned, and I welcome all of the part speakers who are here today as we come together to celebrate. Let's come together in Christ's name as we worship Him in praise. Hymn number 212, we will sing verses 1, 3, and 4.
Entering a new phase
Select 12 men from the people, one from each tribe, and command them, take 12 stones from here out of the middle of the Jordan, from the place where the priest's feet stood. Carry them over with you, and lay them down in the place where you camp tonight. And then Joshua summoned the 12 men from the Israelites whom he had appointed, one from each tribe. Joshua said to them, pass on before the ark of the Lord your God into the middle of the Jordan, and each of you take up a stone on his shoulder, one for each of the tribes of the Israelites, so that this may be a sign among you. When your children ask from time to come, what do these stones mean for you? To you, then you shall tell them that the waters of the Jordan were cut off in front of the ark of the covenant of the Lord. And when it crossed over the Jordan, the waters of the Jordan were cut off. So these stones shall be to the Israelites a memorial forever. The Israelites did as Joshua commanded. They took up 12 stones out of the middle of the Jordan, according to the number of the tribes of the Israelites. Then the Lord told Joshua, carry them over with them to the place where they camped, and lay them down there. Joshua set up 12 stones in the middle of the Jordan, in the place where the feet of the priests bearing the ark of the covenant had stood, and they are there to this day. Second reading comes from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians in chapter 9, and Paul has been appealing to the church in Corinth to be generous in their support of the wider church, in particular the church in Jerusalem. And he's here praising the church in Corinth for their generosity and reminding them of where that generosity comes from and is due. As it is written, he says, he scatters abroad, he gives to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way for your great generosity, which will produce thanksgiving to God through us. For the rendering of this ministry not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also overflows with many thanksgiving to God. Through the testing of this ministry, you glorify God by your obedience to the confession of the gospel of Christ, and by the generosity of your sharing with them and with all others, while they long for you and pray for you because of the surpassing grace of God that he has given you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable word. And thanks be to God for his word to us in these readings. I was joined together in another hymn, in number 606, and we'll sing the four verses of this one.
Park Street members have contributed their memories for our Park Street booklet of history and memories. Members of this committee have compiled these memories and would like to present a few of them today.
Memories. Memories of Park Street members throughout the years. I've heard so many words, memories. Do you remember this today that I think is very appropriate?
In the 1940s, the Sunday school attendance was over 450, including the beginners and primary departments.
I remember being told that I was one of 33 babies baptized in 1940 with water from the Jordan River.
I remember sitting in the back pew of the sanctuary with my grandmother during the 1940s and the 1950s and watching the ladies entering wearing their fancy hats.
I remember when I was young, we celebrated Flower Sunday every year in June. Bird cages with real live birds inside were hung throughout the church, and the birds would sing along with us throughout the service. We always sang, "Birds are singing, woods are ringing." Of course, there were huge bouquets of flowers adorning the sanctuary.
I remember singing, "Here's a famous drawing," as we gave our offering in the beginners of the Sunday school class.
Do you remember the Christmas candlelight services with real candles? The lights were dim, the church was full, with people sitting in the aisles, and the firemen standing at the back of the church.
Growing up, the special services and activities centered within Park Street Church were always the most memorable. The pageant at Christmas, the choirs, both senior and junior, and the special music, the standing room only service at Easter, the Christmas concert in the gymnasium with Santa, the scout service each year, the yearly Kiwanis Music Festival with its performances, the young people's hay rides and dances.
I think my earliest memory of Park Street is the Lola Clark Mission Band. We met in what is now the choir room. Lola was always a hero of mine, a real live missionary.
When I was just a young teen, one of my Sunday school teachers, Mrs. Wood, taught us to pray and feel the presence of God in our quiet time. It was during this time that I knew I would always be a committed Christian.
One of my most treasured memories is of the young people's group that was led by Archie Barrow and Sam Burton. At our peak, we topped 120 members. Mr. Barrow was full of energy, so very faithful, and led us in wonderful singing. Following our own youth service, we filed into the upper side of the balcony of the church to hear the morning service. I remember thinking how fortunate I was to be part of such a dedicated church community.
Greetings and memories of former ministers. Greetings from Reverend Murray Reed Massacre. Roberta and I regret that we will be unable to attend the services at Park Street United Church at the end of this month. We have made previous commitments and must honor them. Our thoughts and our prayers will be with all of you on this special occasion. We have many enduring memories of our time at Park Street Church. Likely, our most deeply felt impression would be of a sensitive, caring congregation which could rise above adversity to meet any challenge confronting it. They did so with a deep sense of loyalty and trust. The congregation will again be in our prayers as the members take this major step in their faith journey. Kindest regards to all, sincerely yours, Murray B. Massacre. Reverend Bruce Small will now share some of his memories of Park Street Methodist Church.
My memories are going to be in that book, so we'll see whether you need it or not. But I have other memories too. Actually, I'm thinking I must be walking in my sleep because I've just been this book. Well, again, it's memories of people. And I remember, I guess, Grace Mills.
Greetings from Reverend Bruce Ross.
1980 to 1985. Too many to itemize in this time slot. However, I especially enjoyed the greeting time at the church doors following worship. This experience was like a bunch of mini pastoral visits, where I had the privilege of exchanging a few words with most of you, a handshake, and even better, a hug. This celebration of a new union joining Park Street and St. Andrews is a dream come true for me. I have hoped for this since I first saw your two congregations a stone throw apart. I am aware of the mixture of excitement and nostalgia, joy and a sense of loss in your various hearts. It's not easy to leave a building which has a life and character of its own, where our ancestors and descendants have been baptized, confirmed, married, and where funerals for loved ones have taken place for 135 years. There's no question in my mind that this is God's will for your congregations, and I'll be praying for the health and faith of this new union. I'll also be praying that God will enable all of you to accept the new challenges and opportunities that will surely develop. Through the years, many of our people have left homes, family, friends, and familiar neighborhoods to serve God in far-flung regions of the planet. I commend such a spirit of adventure and faith to each of you on this historic, and for Helen and me, exciting occasion in Chatham. When you get a few moments, you might hearken to St. Peter's lament as he reminds Jesus that he and his buddies left everything to follow him. Start at Mark 10, verse 28. Helen and I regret very much that we can't be with you today, but we wish you God's richest blessings on this new faith journey. Sincerely in Christ, Helen and Bruce Ross.
Church in the mid-1970s.
camarade, when you were a Park Street leader, scout, or scout?
The CGID Kent County Candlelight Vesper Service was often held in December at our Faith United Church. What a marvelous sight. The church was overflowing with teenage girls wearing their white maidies and dark skirts. Parents of the girls lined the balconies.
During the story time, Reverend Bruce Ross asked the children what they would say to Jesus if they met him on the street. One child responded, "My mom has told me not to speak to strangers."
I remember Bruce Ross at an AOTS barbecue out in Terrace Beach, crawling up a TV aerial, sitting on the roof of the cottage, and playing fiddle around the room with his fiddle. Also, do you remember Reverend Bruce Ross's motorcycle? He often took Park Streeters for a ride, children and adults.
I remember being welcomed back to Park Street after being at another church for a number of years. I remember Reverend Andrew Jensen and his friend Kermit the Frog, the friendship of the choir, the quilters, Unit 7, and for my husband, the AOTS. Everyone truly made us feel welcome.
I remember all of the services and blessings of Sunday school teachers and midweek group leaders. Park Street can be proud of the role it has played in the lives of many young people in our community through the youth group programs. One little beaver comes to mind as he stood in front of the minister and the congregation all alone and said his only purpose was to love God and take care of the world.
The AOTS has maintained a strong and dedicated fellowship for over 32 years. How can anyone forget the wonderful work of the men's club, who raised money from popcorn sales and roast beef dinners in order to fund youth programs in our church and community. One of their special projects for the past 20 years was to provide a Christmas turkey dinner for clients and staff of Mental Health Kent. This grew from a dinner for 20 to 200 throughout the years.
The UCW, formerly Ladies Aid, WA and WNS, have always been dedicated in supporting the work of our local church, the community, and missions throughout the world. To accomplish this, they have had a long history of fundraisers, such as bazaars, catering, rummage sales, suppers, fashion shows, garage sales, etc. Now, just lately, I went over the books of the UCW, which started in 1962, and I totaled up the earnings that they had. They amounted to, roughly speaking, unaudited, this is, $637,800. During the years that they were UCW.
Greetings and memories of former ministers. Memories for Reverend Carl Siebert. There are volumes of precious memories, memories which will be different for each one who ever set foot in this beautiful edifice. What I treasure most are the faithful people at Park Street, from the warm handshake and sincere smile of Tom Yackel at the door, to each and every worshiper in the pews. Partly because the sanctuary was so beautifully and artfully decorated, thanks to Jesse O'Neill and the Banner Bunch, We had many weddings at Park Street. Sometimes the list of them would fill a whole page in the annual report. Do you remember the 145th anniversary service in 1987? The church was packed, I recall. But what I will never forget is the look of two people as I introduced our guest speaker to the chairperson of the planning committee. Bill Alexander came face to face with Lady Alexander, the Lieutenant Governor of Ontario. Both of them thought I had made a mistake in the introductions, and their faces became stern. Then, both Alexanders broke out into a big grin and shook hands. It was such a privilege to serve and celebrate at Park Street United Church. Wherever life's journey will take us, may we move on in faithful fellowship with Christ and each other. Shalom. Carl.
From Reverend Ron Barnum. What I remember most is the number of wonderful, dedicated people, too numerous to mention individually. Specific things that come to mind are the adult study groups, which were really outstanding and stimulated my spiritual growth as well as the growth of all those who participated. Secondly, the good times we had with the Park Street Players, which produced some excellent musical comedy. I'm sorry to see Park Street closed, but nothing stays the same. And I wish everyone well in the next phase of your life journey. Ron Barnum.
From Reverend Ross Williams. I began my ministry at Park Street United Church on April 1, 1990, after my retirement in February of that year. My tenure at Park Street Church was the longest in my ministry. I enjoyed working with Reverend Ron Barnum and the good people in the church. I have many good memories of working with Mildred Melton and her visitation ladies each month. It was a pleasure to work with the AOTS and also to attend the National Convention in Langley, B.C. one year. I was pleased when the church gave support for the Stephen Ministry Program in 1993. Mr. Lloyd Clark, my wife Mary, and I traveled to St. Louis, Missouri to take the two-week training program. Many hours were spent the following years in training and meditation. Mary and I enjoyed being a part of Park Street Players for their three productions. We conducted many services of worship in nursing homes, rest homes, and the hospital. Many good friendships were created in Park Street Church. We want to thank the Park Street people for their many prayers and blessings. Ross Williams.
These are the memories from the Reverend Andrew Jensen. My first experience of Park Street was when I wandered into the Presbytery Resource Center to ask about the process of transferring from the Presbyterian Church to the United Church as clergy. Little did I know that I would end up in Park Street's pulpit. It is sad to face the prospect of this congregation closing its doors and amalgamating with another, but we have known that this was possible for a long time. In fact, when I was first appointed, someone from the presbytery warned me that amalgamation talks were nearly complete and that when Park Street closed, I would be given another appointment right away, most likely out in the country. Boy, was that prediction wrong. When the original amalgamation talks fell apart, Park Street rose to the occasion
to try to make a fresh start. I was encouraged by the energy and enthusiasm shown by so many congregational members. We did make some physical changes in the building, installing a chapel and creating the memorial area in the sanctuary was one of the biggest. But we didn't stop there. The choir room and main weekday entrance had a major facelift, giving weekly visitors to Park Street a fresh and welcoming new appearance. The old nursery became a beautiful meeting room and library, while the old library became a modern and attractive nursery. Of course, the church is not a building, but the people themselves. Park Streeters responded well to the worship changes we made, including some unusual special services. Remember Elvis and the Parkettes? Or the circuit riding preacher on horseback? The congregation also responded generously to George Bannerman and his project in Ghana. I will never forget the immense pile of collected books, clothing, and medical supplies we had gathered in the sanctuary, nor the follow-up visit by a minister of Ghana's government. Locally, Park Street has always been there with food and shelter help for Chatham people in need. I hope that ministry can be continued under the new arrangement. If not, the community will face a great loss with the closing of this church. The hard work of the people of Park Street has made a difference to many lives. I will always have fond memories of so many Park Street members. I won't embarrass anyone by name, but I have no such qualms about the staff. Mary Ann Stokes was there every day doing mountains of typing and answering the phone for all kinds of inquiries. I know for a fact that during my time there, her workload increased tremendously. Thank you, Mary Ann, for your dedication and for all the extra hours you put in. I could not have done it without you. Mark and Debbie Matthews were also there every day. They not only helped me deal with the mysteries of an aging and temperamental building, but they contributed to more programs than many people ever realized. My thanks to the whole Matthews family, and my best wishes to each of them as they go in new directions. Sharon Stepniak, as music director, was willing to try the new worship ideas that came up on a fairly regular basis. While some are quite protective of their space, she was most enthusiastic when we brought in the three cantors and even suggested that we take apart part of the front of the church so that we could catch Anna Sinclair's feet at work on the organ's bells. Thank you, Sharon, for your flexibility. Park Street, I express my gratitude. You were my real introduction to ministry in the United Church. And through our ups and downs together, you taught me a great deal. Thank you for everything. I will never forget you. Reverend Andrew Jensen.
Every week. the karate class as we tried to hold executive council meetings. Working and playing with Sunday school, who gave me a t-shirt with your picture on it when I left. The incredible array of bags which were generously made by Gertrude Smith as a fundraiser. Mark Matthews and his bug collections. Generous members meeting with less fortunate folks and offering food certificates. In Christ, Gail Lucas Rock.
Transition time. And
And thanks to the congregation for your work as you have reached this decision. And one of the things that I remember that has been a blessing to me is the way in which you came together around the in the congregational luncheons over the last two years to reach this decision, because I think it reflected a unity and a pulling together that perhaps was needed at this time in reaching this decision. This morning, you celebrated an anniversary, and I was with my home church in Kingsville celebrating their anniversary, their 100th anniversary of their church building. And it was a time for me of renewing friendship, and it was a sort of family reunion too. But I thought, as we celebrate anniversaries, we celebrate the people, their faith, and their witness, and their ministry for Christ. We mark these the milestones in our life together at anniversaries, and we carry with us the stones that speak of what God has done with us and for us. Stones that speak of who we are. And it seems to me that some of these stones are the memories that you have mentioned, but particularly what has been brought to my notice is the ministry of music, the ministry with youth over the years. You have, in the ministry, the Stephen Ministry of Caring and Parish Nurse, you have led the way in this community. Your outreach to the community has been very gratefully received and welcomed. And these are the stones that mark who you are. They tell your story. And so we carry with us these stones. And when the people of Israel were at the end of their long journey through the desert and about to cross the Jordan, Joshua knew that they needed to know that who they had become through that journey was important for who they would be. Their life as God's people was not over, it was continuing in a new land. And the stones marked some of that growth and that identity that was important for them as they moved on. Remembering is important. It's important as an opportunity to mourn. And mourning is an important part of our experience at this time. We acknowledge our grief, but it also is a way of letting go of the attachments to what is temporal. Remembering is also a time of celebrating, affirming our joy of life together, appreciating the blessings that have given us courage and hope, and be care of the love that has been shared. It is also a time to rediscover our identity, who we are. And I think some of those memories that you have heard came out of an invitation that I gave to the congregation when I first came here, when I laid out some sheets on the platform and Western Hall and invited you to share some of those memories. Those were important in recognizing who you are and who you carry with you into the future. Another part of remembering is being open to God's leading and to the new vision of God's purpose. This is not to say that remembering is without strong feelings, and so we have that sense of loss, of separation, of leaving a home. There's a sense of regret, a sense of failure, perhaps even a sense that ministry has ended. These are natural, but let's remember that we go forward as a community into a new relationship and carry forward the ministry that has a history of serving Christ in this place. That carries with it some sense of uncertainty and perhaps fear. anticipation of new opportunities for ministry. And so we move forward into a new relationship next Sunday in service of amalgamation. And part of that service will involve acknowledging some of the symbols of our life together, symbols of our faith. And these are going to be acknowledged today as we complete this service. These two of the symbols that we will be acknowledging today, the baptismal font and the Bibles, will be acknowledged as gifts from Heart Street in the service next week. The candle and the table will be acknowledged as St. Andrew's symbols that will be brought together as we come together in amalgamation. And so I invite the people that will be reading these next parts, Kay Other, Brendan Kent, Colin Rollins, and Jessica Shaw, to come forward at this time. Just stand in front here and be ready to do your reading.
This baptismal font stands before us as a symbol of God's blessing through the years. Through its water and by prayer, infants, children, and adults have become members of the Church of Jesus Christ and have been welcomed into Park Street United Church. In the waters of baptism, we have died and risen with Christ and received the gift of the Holy Spirit. This font has been a means of blessing for our community. Around this table, generations of people have gathered, and all have been welcomed. We remember those who have gathered as a community of faith here at Christ's table, and were nourished and strengthened for his ministry in this community and the world. This table has been a means of calling us together, binding us to one another in a spirit of commitment and love.
Thank you.
As we conclude this time together of remembrance and giving thanks, let's join together in the living of Thanksgiving, or leading of Thanksgiving. I invite you to join in the response of part and whole of faith. Jesus said, "Where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them."
Let's sit.